So, first of all, I want to like to thank the organizers for inviting us all to this beautiful place. And so I'm going to talk about the theoretical view.
Can you speak up?
The microphone is not working, or?
You need to help the microphone.
Okay. I don't know. It's okay. So is it better? Okay, great. So I want to give you the theoretical view on the experiment that has just been presented by Thomas before the break. And so I worked together with Jinhong Park and Yuval, who is here at the Weizmann Institute. And
it's not better?
Okay, I'll try to be a bit louder for you. So I think here's okay. So the experiment has been carried out in the group of Thomas Ihn and Klaus Enslin by Tobias Krenmann and Mark Rösli, and Mark Rösli is also in the audience. And but first of all, I want to take a step back. Since we have the quantum Hall effect, it has become possible to implement the originally optical interferometers in condensed matter systems. So, for example, it is now become possible to create the Mach-Zehnder, the Hong-Mandel, or the Hanbury-Brown and Twiss interferometers. And in the electronic versions, there's the particles that interfere are not photons, but they are electrons. And because of that, they interact with the other electrons in the Fermi sea of the devices, and this gives rise to a decrease in visibility in the interference fringes in those experiments. So the question is, why would you do this at all? Because photons do this perfectly without these problems. But so I think the goal is eventually to make visible interference between fractionally charged quasi-particles in those systems. And to understand how those particles interact, which generates this dissipation and decoherence, it is very important to identify the mechanisms behind those effects. And so there's been, for example, this experiment here where a non-equilibrium distribution is introduced into quantum Hall edge at filling factor nu equals 2 by a quantum point contact. And this non-equilibrium distribution is initially a double-step distribution. And as this distribution propagates along the channel, it gets smoother and smoother. And before it is energetically probed at a quantum dot. And quite surprisingly, on the way from the quantum point contact to the quantum dot, the distribution loses a significant part of its energy to degrees of freedom that are unknown. So the mechanism for this energy loss has so far not been determined. And in a further experiment, in which a non-equilibrium distribution is introduced into a nu equals 2 edge by an RF circuit, there's the same problem. So in this experiment, this distribution propagates either to this ohmic contact here, or here this QPC can be opened so that part of the distribution travels in another part of the sample. And in this way, the authors of this paper were able to show that the interaction between the charge carriers is first of all finite ranged, and also here there is an energy loss due to a mechanism that is so far not been determined. And but now I want to go to the experiment that has been presented by Thomas. And so as you saw, it allows to energy resolved transfer electrons along a quantum Hall edge. So the energy of the incoming electrons is fixed and the energy of the outgoing electrons is fixed. And in this way, they were able to show that there were distinct signatures in the energy landscape of this emitter and detector quantum dot. And the goal of the theory is now to relate those signatures to the underlying physical processes by a diagrammatic approach in order to identify and confirm the origin of those relaxation mechanisms. So first of all, so here's a somewhat more basic version of the sample that has just been shown to you by Thomas. So there's a source lead which introduces, so this is biased and introduces electrons through the emitter quantum dot into this reservoir region. And because of the strong perpendicular magnetic field, the electrons propagate here along the edge before they end up at the detector, which is again a resonant level by a quantum dot, before the current is measured here in the drain. And I also want to briefly again run through the phenomenology of the experiment because it's arguably the most important part. So as you've seen, so in this first triangle here, so this side of the triangle is just determined by this side of the triangle corresponds to equal emission and detection energies. And then if I go along this lower side of the triangle here, the detection energy is smaller than the emission energy. And so here there's a clear current, which is due to electrons losing energy before exiting the device. And as you've seen, there's also a signal when the detector quantum dot is below the Fermi C and the emitter quantum dot is above the Fermi C. And the energy of those holes is just equal or smaller to the injection energy of this incoming electron here. And then, surprisingly, there was also this signal when the detector quantum dot level is higher than the level of the injected electrons. And so if you did not catch before how this can happen, then you have another chance now. And we also see the same phenomenon for holes. So here in this point, the the emitter is just aligned with the reservoir chemical potential and the detector is below here. So, okay. So first of all, to describe the experiment, I need a model. And I want to use the simplest model that gives me an inelastic current in all of the four triangles. And what I'm using is the following. So I have, for each of the edges, I just take a single channel. So one for the emitter here, one for the drain, and one for this intermediate region. And all of them are held at a certain chemical potential. And to connect the channels, I tunnel here to a quantum dot, which represents the emitter just by a single resonant level. And I have the same on the right side here for the detector, which is also tunnel coupled to the intermediate region and the drain. And so I just want to give you a brief glimpse of the underlying formula through the drain lead. So this is the most important formula because this is the observable we are interested in. So initially this looks very complicated. It's derived with Keldysh non-equilibrium Green's functions technique. But the expression has a very nice intuitive interpretation, I would say. So you can see that this Green's function here, which describes the right lead. So here I have the lesser component of the Green's function. And this essentially means that an electron comes from here. And then here I have tunneling through the detector quantum dot. And so here no equilibration happens. This is described by just a retarded Green's function. And then in the end, this electron that has been emitted here is caught in the middle region. And here I write a large G because this G develops with the Hamiltonian of the entire system. So this contains the right lead, the intermediate region, and also the left lead, as well as eventual interactions, which I need to introduce later. And so this can be written in this form because I treat this dot and this lead always non-interacting, and then you can follow, for example, this reference to derive a formula. And so first of all, the non-interacting case can be solved exactly. And what I get here is just a Landauer-Bütikofer result. This means that so here I get a contribution which depends on the occupation in the left lead and the occupation in the right lead. And you can see here there's a transmission through the left dot. So the electrons which come from here have to be transmitted through the left dot, and then they go along the intermediate region before they are again transmitted into the right lead. And I have a second term where now enters the distribution of the in the intermediate region. And here you can see that the electron comes from here, first has to be reflected before it is transmitted into the detector. And the transmission probability here is just given by a Lorentzian, which is centered on the resonant levels of the two dots. And there's some broadening because of the coupling both to the left and to the intermediate region lead. And this reflection coefficient is just 1 minus transmission. So in pictures, this looks like this. So the first term I just described gives me the elastic transfer of electrons when the emitter and detector level are aligned. So this corresponds to this line here. And the second term corresponds to this vertical line here. So whenever, as Thomas explained very nicely, whenever this quantum dot level is between the reservoir and the drain chemical potentials, the current flows. So this is why this is independent of the left quantum dot. And you can see that, yeah, as you saw, this also arises in the experiment because it's not possible to perfectly align the reservoir and the drain chemical potential. If you raise the drain chemical potential, then the current just flows, of course, from the drain to the reservoir in the other direction. But since we are theoreticians, we can allow ourselves to align those chemical potentials. And as you can see, in the non-interacting case, not a lot is going on. So there is only this elastic transfer of electrons. Yeah. Ah, yes. So this is, so E and H bar is equal to 1. So this is E gamma divided by H bar. Yeah. And so, yeah. So in order to make this a little more interesting, I thus need to introduce interactions. And first I introduce interactions in the reservoir region here. I'm going to consider second order diagrams and only one transmission event per quantum dot. So there is also an approximation for tunneling now. And I consider a finite range model interaction. And I'm considering finite range interactions because so if you only have one channel and you consider contact interactions, which is very usual, for example, when people solve large interliquid, then so for one channel and the contact interaction, you do not get any relaxation because the electrons cannot be in the same place because of the Pauli principle in the same channel. But by allowing for some screened interaction, which is a bit more finite in range, it becomes possible for the electrons to release their energy. And so the first consequence of interactions in the reservoir region is that the elastic current actually decays. So I0 is the value of the elastic current without interactions. And then so I get from my interactions, I get another term here. So E is a function that I'm going to plot just in a second. X is the separation of the dots, and V is the Fermi and the Fermi velocity. And you can see that this elastic current decays now as the energy of the two quantum dots is raised from the Fermi level. And so particularly for my one-channel model with finite range interactions, this looks like this. So up to a certain injection energy, which is equal to the Fermi velocity over my screening length, there is no relaxation at all. But then this quickly rises and causes this current to decay along this line. And so this is a consequence of the Pauli principle. So for those low energies, the polarization and the exchange diagram, they just compensate each other. And so here's also a drawback of perturbation theory. If you increase the time it takes for the particles to go from dot to dot by too much, then this will become negative, which is of course unphysical. But you can show that if you sum further contributions in the perturbation series, then everything is fine. And so the Green's function which governs the decay of this elastic current is also the Green's function which governs the visibility, for example, in the Mach-Zehnder interferometer, as has been shown in this paper. And so now to the inelastic currents. So the way it works now is the following. So this is now, as an example, a polarization diagram which describes interactions between electrons in the reservoir region. And so the diagram is terminated by tunneling through the right lead because I'm calculating the current in this right lead in the detector or drain. And so this is how the diagram looks without, if there was no tunneling. But now since I can tunnel from the reservoir region into both the source and the drain, I need to dress the Green's function lines here with this tunneling so that I get, in this way, I get 27 different diagrams which all describe equilibration processes. And if I divide those diagrams in the middle, then the physical process is revealed. The other half of the diagram gives me the complex conjugate, so because it will be probabilities. And for my approximation on tunneling, only three processes contribute in those triangles, and those processes I want to show you now. So first, you can see that this diagram here describes the electron comes from the source, tunnels into the intermediate region, interacts with electrons in the intermediate region, and before it tunnels out to the right quantum dot. In the energetic landscape, you can image this like this. So the electron comes in, loses some of its energy, escapes through the detector at a lower energy, while an electron hole pair is created here. And so if I calculate the contribution of this diagram at zero temperature and for sharp filters, then the contribution of the diagram is exactly confined to this lower left triangle here. And so one subtlety because of the finite range interactions is that the contribution of the diagram is closely located to the elastic line, because if you have a finite range interaction, then this will cut your interaction strength off as the photon energy is increased. And here the photon energy is just determined by omega L minus omega R, so it's fixed here. And this means that as omega L minus omega R gets larger and larger, the contribution gets more and more suppressed. Then the second diagram, here an electron again comes in from the left lead, tunnels into the intermediate reservoir region and generates an electron hole pair. But here not the original electron escapes escapes to the detector, but the electron of the electron hole pair goes through the detector. So in the energy landscape, this might look something like this. So the original electron loses some energy, creates this electron hole pair, and now the electron from the Fermi C escapes through the detector. And so this diagram also exactly contributes in the outline of this first triangle here. And the photon energy is here determined by the distance of the injection energy to the Fermi C, or the detection energy to the Fermi C, which causes us to be closer located to the chemical potential of the intermediate region. But now, since the initial conditions of the two processes are the same and the electrons are indistinguishable, we need to take this into account, and this is exactly achieved by the exchange diagrams. So here you can see that the left side of the exchange diagram just corresponds to the first process I just showed, and the right side of the diagram corresponds to the second process. And so this describes the interference of the two processes. And here the second exchange diagram just gives you the complex conjugate of the first one. And then there's the third process, which remains from those diagrams. And in the third process, the whole of the electron hole pair that is created in the intermediate region now escapes through the detector. And this diagram now exactly contributes in the outline of the lower blue triangle that is, as it is seen in the experiment. And also in this case, there's an exchange diagram, which is not so easy to interpret, but so this guarantees that when the screening length goes to zero, then there's the Pauli principle, and the current will become zero. So, and now how about the inverted triangles? So relatively early in the project, our friends from the ETH came to us with the following suggestion. So as Thomas explained before, a possible process is that first an electron escapes here into the, or goes from the emitter into the intermediate region, leaves behind a hole in the source. This hole can recombine with another source electron, and this recombination energy can be transferred to the intermediate region, where an electron can now be excited to an energy that is higher than the energy of the emitted electron. And so in order to test this, so we included interactions between the reservoir and the source leads of the sample into the theoretical model. And so there are some subtleties. So I'm using a very simple model where the source actually runs parallel to the reservoir channel. And I take into account the additional distance of reservoir and source by phenomenologically by modifying my interactions depending on this distance. And in this case, again, I have to dress my interaction diagrams with tunneling. But here, the interaction, as you see, takes place between the intermediate region and the source lead. And again, within my approximation, only three of those processes contribute. The first process is essentially in structure identical to the first process I've shown you before. But the second process is now the following. So here, the electron still interacts in the source lead before it tunnels into the intermediate region and creates an electron hole pair also in the intermediate region, which corresponds to the process that has been suggested to us. And if you calculate then the contribution of the diagram, it exactly contributes in this upper inverted triangle that was first so surprising in the experiment. And also because the charge carry is again excited from the Fermi C, the contribution increases towards the Fermi C. Then the final diagram, the whole of the electron hole pair escapes through the detector, and we get the current exactly in the whole inverted triangle. And so now on this slide, I want to show you all contributions, including elastic current combined. And you can see that, so a drawback of the theory is that this absence of the elastic current that is so largely seen in the experiment cannot be captured. So this is just not within our allowed parameter range. So this feature we cannot capture. And it's also necessary to say that so to get quantitative agreement between experiment and theory takes into account lots and lots of other effects, such as higher interaction orders, as I just said, for this inelastic line. Then you would have to think about sample geometry, then more channels, because so the relaxation process in those regular triangles is most likely due to interchannel relaxation, and you need. Probably you need to calculate everything at non-zero temperature. Then you need to have interactions between channels and the dots to describe the Fermi edge singularity that has been described to you by Thomas. So, so quantitative agreement is out of reach. And so I want to briefly show this extended setup that you've also seen before. So here it was necessary to. So here is now this extra circuit with the right lead, the left lead, and the sensor quantum dot. And so no electrons can tunnel from this side to this side. So all the current you measure in the sensor are just electron hole pairs that are excited in this right lead by recombination processes in the other parts of the sample. And so This triangle, as Thomas explained, corresponds to processes in which source electrons here recombine and excite electron hole pairs in the right, which can then tunnel. And plugging in this energetic situation into the theory, we can also show that this gives you a current in exactly this region of the sensor and emitter energy landscape. And so there's also a small signal here. And this is most likely due to recombination processes in the reservoir. And also this I enter into the theory, and energetically it exactly corresponds to that. So the interaction for this process really has to bridge from the reservoir region to this right contact. And so to come back to the introductory slides, so since we know now that a finite range interaction can excite electron hole pairs in remote parts of such devices, it is not inconceivable that this non-equilibrium distribution here loses energy when it passes, for example, those pinched off contacts in this experiment. And also here, where they have shown that in their experiment, the interaction is actually finite ranged, it is not inconceivable that energy is lost to the other channels in the sample, which are not controlled in the experiment. Okay, so to conclude, so the distinct contributions to the measured current are captured. So this theoretical approach qualitatively accounts for current in all of the four triangles in which current has been measured in the experiments. And I think so by this effort of experiment and theory together, we now confirmed that the origin of those inverted triangles is because of interactions between spatially separated parts of the sample. And on the theoretical side, we saw that second order interactions are not sufficient to capture some qualitative features. So one probably has to resort to bosonization techniques here. And as I said, the quantitative agreement is currently or maybe indefinitely out of reach at this point. And so I hope I could convince you that relaxation dynamics is a very rich but also challenging phenomenon. And with this, I want to thank you for your attention.